these alive images feel like they're almost speaking to you. Living, breathing bodies, telling you the stories they have lived and experienced. The evidence of time carried by these bodies is captured in these visuals. And by captured, I don't mean photographed. These astounding visuals are real paintings, captured by hand by an artist born in the town of Umrade in Nagpur district. Weren't you surprised when you realized that these are paintings? Well, that is the usual response. The artist of these paintings lives every scar on the bodies as he paints them so patiently. And his style of painting is commonly known as hyperrealism. The viewer often gets overwhelmed by the sheer level of detail in these paintings. But when you spend some time with them, you feel yourself drawn towards their essence. Let the layers reveal themselves and listen to the stories they tell you. Hello and welcome to iTalk. I am Ruchita Kanpillewar from 2011 batch of Ideas, and I am very glad to introduce to you the artist behind these paintings, Parag Sonarghare. Today we have the opportunity to listen to the story of the artist and his journey from the man himself. Thank you for giving us your time.
Thank you, Rajita, for inviting me. Actually, thank you for this all endeavor. Rather, this is a very wonderful thing to have this interaction. And I feel good rather to have this interaction coming from a college or people from my city where I've lived for a longer time.
Yeah.
So I'm quite happy to be here.
This is the first time we are having an artist for our iTalk session. Previously, we've had architects, archaeologists, mm-hmm. but we have been following your work for quite a few years, and
okay.
we all see you as an inspiration.
Mm-hmm.
And we would love for this inspiration to be shared among a lot of our friends and other viewers too. So I would like to take this opportunity to know you more, get some personal insights, and know your journey and more about your work. So I have a question for you. The first, as I said, the first impact that your paintings have is, wow, is it a photograph? And that technical perfection is mind-blowing. So how did you reach this point?
So I would say it's, when it comes to hyperrealism, basically it's part of my practice. So I do not necessarily do hyperrealism for the sake of it, but it's part of my language. I use it as a tool.
Right.
So, like, and I have evolved to this stage. Earlier, my work was a bit different. Rather, there have been many stages, and eventually, I'm coming to this point where I'm venturing into this. Though it is commonly known as hyperreal, but I basically look for my own expression. And
yeah.
hyperrealistic style or that genre tends to be part of it.
Right.
So, my deliberate attempt is not hyperrealism,
right.
but what I do with that.
So, it's not intentional that you follow this particular genre.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I rather even I would say that I'm not a hyperrealistic artist or something.
Right.
It's just since it is helping with my expression to put my visual language ahead in a painting, or you know, if I can project it through that. So it's just a tool for me, honestly speaking.
Right. So whatever you project, do you get an expected response from people, or is it bizarre?
So it's basically very different from people to people. Whenever I come across like, you know, there are many responses. Some people see it as a pure technical thing.
Yeah.
There are very few people who get it that what I have done and what I'm trying to do with the subjects I paint and why they are there in the painting, rather than just focusing on the technique. Basically, whenever I interact with people, or you know, they come with a response, they always come with an awe. And you know, this is so, and it's almost like a photograph. It's almost like a, you know, super real skill, and it's something amazing what they have seen for the first time, maybe.
Yes.
But for me, I'm trying to go beyond that skill. It's more about what has been shown there through that skill. So that's how I rather want to focus on the subject and the visual what I've presented as a painter or as an artist, but then it's up to every individual how they respond to it.
Right. So what are you exactly trying to portray through those subjects? As we say that art deals with reality and fantasy. So art, the technique of art, they say,
is to alter the reality and
mm-hmm.
present it in a way that the audience perceives it from a different perspective,
mm-hmm.
perceive their reality from a different
mm-hmm.
perspective.
Mm-hmm.
That's what artists show, is what
mm-hmm.
they say.
Mm-hmm.
So what is your intention behind, what is the message, or what is the expression you're trying to create through these paintings?
So basically, I have evolved with time, and I have been following many things in past years, and the way I have started from my college days, then into profession, and then starting my own practice, and evolving through that as well. But in recent years, basically, I try and capture evidences. I mean, I rather see people are almost like a walking book, and what they carry, their experiences are part of their body. Part of their body, in the sense, their experience is quite visible. The kind of life they are living actually get imprinted on their body with time and with age. And I see that body itself as a painting. So that's why I try and capture that painting, that body, that time, that evidence. And somewhere I try and relate it to me, or try and relate with my practice, or how do I want to see it. So it's almost like when I paint them, it's almost like looking into the mirror, and this is me. So
okay.
you're basically trying to relate yourself with another visual, how you're getting represented, or your mind or heart, or all these inner not cravings, but inner maybe
desires and
all those, the way you want your existence. So maybe if people would want to remember me, I would want them to be, I wouldn't want them to remember me in a particular way. So that particular way is what I do.
So you see yourselves as all shades of human existence, or you feel that all of us are connected in some way? Every human being is connected in certain way.
Definitely we are connected, yet we are very different from each other. So I definitely try and look at the general aspect as well, and yet that individuality. So that's part of my work as well.
How did you come about painting people, and most of them are men? Your paintings have no backgrounds.
Okay.
So how did you choose to, or was it natural to choose to paint these men in a very raw and exposed manner, and focusing on them?
So basically, what we see generally in India, mostly female body is all covered. So my way of approach is like, you have to digest the visual first within you. So I need to be exposed to, to look at female body, and that too, I paint bare people, like, without clothes.
Yes.
So I have to be digesting it first. I just don't want to, imitate it through photograph.
Right.
So I need to have that experience first, and yet I am very choosy when it comes to my visual. But when it comes to male, we almost see them half naked everywhere. I mean, whenever we travel, or it's quite common, workers and everything. So that way, I know, how male body behaves, what sort of structure it has, and it's quite familiar to me.
Right.
And I also see like a lot of evidences. I don't say that, you won't find any evidences on the female body. Female body has its own beauty, which I do understand, but I am yet to consume it in that manner where I would like to express it. So that's one thing. And since it is also about availability, what is available and how you are getting drawn to it. So in that context, I was trying to find people. Sometime they came across, and it was a kind of serendipity.
Run into them. But all these paintings, are these from different places? Have you traveled a lot, and do you take pictures first?
I have tried doing that as well, but mostly people I have painted are coming from Baroda.
Okay.
Flea market, what I visit, and then some working people in somewhere.
Mm.
Some of them were beggars. So it is not that I want to focus on them, but rather I want to focus on the evidence of life, like what is coming from that life. And they are wearing as a normality, as a normal thing. We may see it in a contextual manner, but for them, it's a usual
the most
thing.
Comfortable.
Yeah, exactly. So that way, I try and capture what they are, irrespective of what they are trying to talk, what is their condition and all that. Rather, I want to take exactly as, maybe it's a selfish act.
Why do you say it's a selfish act? And
Cause,
When you say you
yeah.
want to replicate or portray their state of being, what inspires you to do that? And most artists are into self-expression. They want to express their own feelings and own thoughts. But you do it through another entity. So why that?
So, I mean, in a very similar way, what you said is, in a very similar way I do it. It's just that my expression is their body. I mean, their body as in, not body, but the visual, but the whole experience, the like maybe those scars, those detailings. And I mean, there's no rationale behind it that why do I do that? But it's somehow, I feel like looking into the mirror. I feel like, you know, going into it, and it almost feels like, oh, this is me. This is where my existence is.
So you've said this the word scars and evidence many times. Has any particular incident inspired this? I sense something like that.
Okay. There have been a couple of incidents, but I would like to start with my how I have evolved, like
yes, please.
How my practice has evolved
share
over
about
the
your
years.
journey. Yeah.
So, I have done my BFA and MFA, MFA in artistry from Baroda, BFA from Nagpur itself. So, we had this thing that we have to paint three figures in a painting, and then only it will be considered as painting.
Okay.
It was quite a compulsion. And you still have in rather regional colleges, you have this traditional teaching techniques. And now it is changing, but like a lot of regional colleges still have a particular approach of way of approach towards learning and teaching and everything. So three figures were part of like it was mandatory to have three figures or figuration in the painting. And I was somehow I was inclined towards realism. And I used to copy a lot of, even in my childhood, I used to copy a lot of drawings. So I used to do pencil drawings, renderings and all
graphite.
That. Graphite, yeah, true. So I used to copy them a lot. So I did not know that this would lead to this. But now I can, you know, see that thread from where it is coming. So after, so I was interested in people, rather I would say I was not good at portraits. So I did not know that I would be painting portraits.
That is strange.
So yeah, so even like I like on an earlier stage, I had these suggestions that Parag, do not go into figuration. Your figuration is not that good. Rather, your figuration is weak. So rather try and do something else.
Okay.
But I did not dwell much into that opinion and was rather trying to find my own practice. Then I went to Baroda for masters.
Yes.
And everything changed. Why everything changed? Because Baroda, art practice in Baroda is very different. I mean, it took me around 6 months to digest that practice first. Oh, this is art as
to
well.
To get used to it.
Yeah, yeah. So, this is art as well. Okay. So, I had seen, I remember a strong memory that I had seen a broken wall, piece of wall, which has been put into the gallery and that was there as an art, I mean, artwork.
Okay.
It was exhibited as artwork. And I was, okay. I was like, okay. And then it took me like little time to digest it or, you know, to get aligned to it or to, you know, to get that whole feeling. Oh, this is an art as well. But then slowly I had started my practice after my master's. So during those 2 years of artistry, I really didn't do much of painting.
It's more of learning and gathering.
Right. Gathering experiences. I used to visit painting department and what other students are doing. Even I wasn't really that vocal at that point of time. And I was just trying to observe since I had come from a very different background. And then I had started my practice slowly. And like I was trying to follow Baroda mannerism of painting or their approach towards, you know, how one should be, you know, painting or how one should be expressing visually. But then slowly also I had this background of painting from Nagpur.
Right.
So I had visited a residency. I was part of a residency where I had seen, rather in Baroda, sorry, I'm again going back. So when I was in art history, I've become aware of this this thing called performance art.
Yes.
And
yes,
I had done something like performance during my bachelor's.
Okay.
So, but I did not know that this can be, you know, this can evolve into performance art later or this can be a leading point into my practice as well. But since I've become aware about performance art in Baroda and I could connect the thread where in bachelor's during my final year I had painted my body, rather not me, but I had asked painters to paint my body, like local painters
had your body
yeah
painted.
yeah yeah
oh. Okay.
So I got my body painted through them, and then I clicked my photographs. I mean, I've asked definitely friends to click my photographs, and I've used those photographs of me in the painting. So I was painting me being photographed into, you know,
okay.
I was transferring them into
paintings,
photographs into paintings.
Okay.
So I was using them as a reference.
Right.
And but I was not sure at that point of time. Okay, I was just doing my own impulsive,
you
know,
felt like in
yeah,
the moment.
Whatever I felt like very strongly, that too, intensely. So I went on doing that, and then later I could connect the thread that, you know, this can be a performance. Painting your own body or getting painted can be a performance.
Okay.
So since I was aware of that, I was aware of that, and later when I got to be a part of a residency.
Which residency was that?
So basically, it was organized by Art and Deal. Art and Deal is a magazine, but Art Consult is a gallery.
Was
so
it in Baroda?
No. This was in Delhi.
Okay.
So they had organized a residency, and they had invited me. And I mean, you could do anything basically. It was not restricted that you have to
visual
do performance
arts.
Or
okay.
visual arts. So you know,
anything.
You could do your own experiment and you know just go there, work there. It was in Jagannath Puri near Bhubaneswar. So then we were visiting this heritage village where, you know, mostly artists lives. So they do Pattachitra painting.
Yeah, Pattachitra
painting, yeah. So that village is called Raghurajpur. So when I had visited that village for the first time, I wasn't really aware what exactly is there. But when I came back, you know, and when I was trying to, you know, recollect all those memories, my head was full of visuals. So I went there empty, with empty head or with empty perception of, you know, what I'm going to see. But when I came back after the experience, my head was full of, impression, those visuals and everything. So, but at one point of time, I thought, okay, can I really turn this into a very physical thing? You know, this is what I have in my mind. But let me turn into a, let me, you know, have this as a physical thing. So then later when I again went there, I asked those painters, Pattachitra painters, to paint whatever they do as their practice on my body.
Okay.
So basically I was half naked and then they painted my body. Definitely we recorded it for the, maybe wanted to make a stop animation or something like that, want to see how it is evolving and everything. And then, but they painted me like wholesomely, like whole, I had become a Pattachitra painting.
You were a canvas.
Yeah, I was a canvas. And then I thought of painted canvas. I was a canvas, then again painted thing. And then I took a walk. I mean, from...
Yes, we've seen pictures
right,
from that.
Right. So I had taken a walk on the beach road as well in Puri, where it was almost like sharing that experiences.
Yes.
That I'm coming from this place. And that's why I have these visuals.
So you carry it with you as an exhibit.
Exactly,
yourself.
Exactly. So I was almost acting like a gallery,
right.
Walking gallery.
Exactly.
So, and that was my performance. So later, I also ventured into like many other things. So I was doing parallel performances, and then since after artistry, I had also this influence of iconography, and then I was also interested in kitsch art,
kitsch
popular art.
Yes.
So then I thought of using all this elements as material, and then trying to draw, you know, not something, but trying to draw my own expression from it. So earlier there was a lot of contemporary elements which were happening, like not contemporary but present at that point of time, which were part of so there was this fashion of wearing Superman t-shirt like around 7-8 years ago. So then I had painted myself in a Superman t-shirt.
Even I had a Superman t-shirt at that point.
Yeah. So I was quite fascinated by it, and I was also seeing one thing that, you know, everyone is Superman. So, you know, even in our philosophy, or we all are capable of
Aham Brahmasmi.
Yeah, that was actually that is actually a title of my work. Aham Brahmasmi.
Is it the body painting work that you're talking about?
Body painting plus a body painting work was Metamorphosis.
Yes.
But I have done quite a few performances which were called as Aham Brahmasmi, where I was trying to
cosmos.
Yeah. Where I was also trying to inquire within me.
Yes.
That who am I?
Exactly.
So these I mean, I went ahead with that. Then there was this thing with plastic. I had been experimenting plastic in the sense I have painted myself wrapped in a plastic. I had almost covered my whole home with plastic and me in front of that structure. So that was also one of performance. And parallelly I was doing paintings. So earlier I was interested in almost let's say commentary, like contemporary commentary on things, the
what's
way I've
happening?
Almost like expressing over present situations.
Situation as in situations in your personal life? Or
no, no,
surrounding?
in general. I used to take like a general social political movement, what is, but not corely social political, but just what is trending,
exists.
what is existing, what is the driving force these days. So that's why I used to take it. And so I remember doing a work which was called as Shower of Blessings, but the look, and it was all, I had taken iconography of a Lakshmi, where there were these two gaja elephants showering on me. I mean, I was seated in a barber chair. Why I had used it is just because that chair is available for everyone. So I was there wearing a shower cap, and for the lotus thing I had used wash basin.
Okay.
Where it is all draining out. So I'm all covered.
The
whole shower is going away,
right.
Draining away.
So you can't receive the blessing.
Exactly. And I am the one who is who can be blamed for that. It's basically what we choose.
I'm choosing to wear this.
Exactly, exactly, exactly. So which I could see very visibly, very much visible in society. So that is one thing. Then I remember another, I would say good work, definitely that's a good work. The title of the work was Main Kutta Hoon, where there was this movement which was happening for Lokpal Bill, and Anna Hazare had this slogan, not Anna Hazare, but everyone who was supporting Anna Hazare at that point of time was saying Main Anna Hoon. So they were at the good side of let's say life, or good side of they were going for a good cause. But I was within me also trying to see that who would be taking the blame then. Why don't we let's say address those issues which is problematic within us. So I was also inclined towards this element of dog, which can be positive and which can have a negative effect as well. So that duality, that whole paradox within that whole thing is became a very prominent part of my work. And then I'm saying I had covered myself in the painting, the visual of the painting is I've covered myself in a plastic. There's this dog which is wearing this Halloween,
we have seen this
Halloween horns, and the title of the work is Main Kutta Hoon. So it's let's say dog has these two elements, lustful and the loyal. So which one is me? So it's almost like contemplating within you that who am I again?
We are made of dualities.
Right.
So you look a lot into yourself. This has been your journey of inward looking and exploring yourself. So we would like to talk about or ask you about the turning point in your life.
Right. So since like I was doing these sort of stuff, my paintings were very colorful, but I wasn't really satisfied within me. I mean, I remember telling my friend that, you know, I'm doing something, I'm okay with it, but I'm not getting that, that, let's say, that kick or that satisfaction or that sense of, you know, being there or seeing that as a mirror.
Do you feel that inner belonging to your art is important and listening to your inner calling?
Yes, very much. I mean, that's how you become very honest with your own expression. Then why do you call that as your expression? You have to have a direct relationship.
Yeah,
that's what I feel.
Authentic and genuine.
Yeah, very true, very true. I would rather I come from the traditional mentality, if that is traditional.
Coming back to your turning point.
Turning point is basically I was interested, happy, but not really satisfied. Something was, you know,
something was missing.
And like on 2014, like very first day of 2014, I met with an accident, and that point I see that as, you know, I generally divide my work into pre-accident and post-accident phase. So that post-accident phase is what you see today.
Yes.
And pre-accident phase is what I was doing earlier with all those colorful work.
Yeah.
So after accident, I almost took 8 months of break. 3 months I was bedridden, and then almost took 8 months of break and restarted my practice. So at that point of time, I wasn't really interested in painting because painting was taking so long time. Like at that point of time, I used to take around 25 days to finish a painting, almost a month, let's say. So I was not so happy spending that much of time for a single painting. Rather, I was interested in performance. You know, you prepare in your mind and you do it in few hours.
It's a quick communication.
Exactly, exactly. So I was quite interested in that, and I was like,
doing this before the accident as well.
Yeah, I was doing performance before the accident.
This happened.
And then after accident, I thought of let's not paint anymore, because painting is taking so long time, and it is not suiting to my, you know, it doesn't really suit to my way of expression the way I want it now.
Okay.
Let's paint, let's do performance.
Okay.
So I was fully in that zone, and I had couple of offers which were ready to, you know, to showcase, or rather to have me as a performance artist in their let's say ventures or exhibitions. And in the meantime, I got like Space Studio in Baroda. I had applied for it, and they almost said, okay, you can become a part, like you can practice here.
Do you still practice there?
No, I have my own studio now. I've been practicing there for around couple of years, more than couple of years maybe. So then during that point of time, when I had time, when I was thinking about performances, something didn't really connect to that very opportunity which I was having. And then I thought, since I have time, let me paint. At least I can paint, so let me not waste my time and let me start painting. But I mean, from that point to till date, I haven't really looked back into performance.
So what was going on in your mind when you had those 8 months to just stop?
I have this very wonderful memory that the gallerist who were representing me at that point of time from Chicago, she was telling me, Monica Badlani, I would like to take her name. She was telling me that, you know, she was trying to tell me another story of a chef in Chicago. He had been through some similar things and how he has evolved after accident. So I prominently remember that she has been asking Parag, do you see anything, similar happening to you, within you, or is, you know, maybe she was also trying to encourage me. But at that point of time, I did not really know, like, you know, what I can answer, or I was just trying to listen to her and just not contemplate even. I was just trying to listen to her. And then it took me my practice, and later when I started, then I realized that, you know, that point is actually this. So then slowly I started building up towards my expression. And one prominent thing after accident, like post accident, what I saw in my practice is intensity. I wanted everything to be like intensified, not very deliberately, but it was coming from within that,
but
you know,
yeah, sorry to interrupt.
No worries.
It's very noticeable that there is a density now. The intensity is more focused.
Right. So, I mean, I'm glad that you see it this way. It is like that. I mean, for almost for a year after I've started my practice, I almost went on every painting like this would be my last painting, let's say. So I had also this fear of, you know, losing my expression in the sense, if I die tomorrow, what I'm going to leave behind. So if this is going to be my last painting, how am I going to do it? So that should be very grand. That should be very intense. That should be very, let's say, experience giving. So I would say earlier my work, the colorful kind of work I was doing, was more of an image making. But these days what I do is I'm more concerned about experience it is giving. And in a later stage, that painting on the body, like almost I was masking the body. I was trying to hide the identity of that person, and I wanted that visual or that person to adapt somebody else's character.
Exactly.
But I wasn't really interested in it after this post-accident thing. In post-accident thing rather. So then I do not know what sort of enlightenment or what sort of awareness, you know, I become aware about. Or I also see that, you know, 2015 and 16 was my year of spiritual growth as well. And what clicked, I really cannot tell you. But I mean, I cannot even tell myself, but it was happening within me, and I was.
It's like earlier you see yourself as water, getting adapted to anything that comes along, and then you develop a sense of identity, individuality more.
Right, right, right,
that.
Right. Maybe you
Something
can put it
like
that
that
way. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Very true. So I started seeing things very clearly that what I want and what I do not really want. When I say hyperrealism happened to be there, what I really wanted to say is I did not deliberately include it. Rather, I went with the necessity of having it in my practice. I did not plan hyperrealism, but I really went for detail, what I really want in my painting and how do I want it and what I really want to paint it. So I went behind the content, what I want to paint, and alongside hyperrealism followed. That's what people know generally, like, you know, what is hyperrealism. So if you ask me, like, do you really consider yourself as an artist who is painting into hyperrealism? So it's just a tool, what I've mentioned mentioned earlier as well. It's just a tool, but my primary focus is my visual and experience coming from it. So skill comes later. So they say a very good thing that, you know, art needs skill, but skill is not art. And I totally follow it. That, you know, that's why hyperrealism is a tool. And not hyperrealism as a prominent part of my practice.
That is why that's also one question I had. We read one of your interviews from Asian Curator, which started with the first two lines of the interview, published interview, were that Parag Sonagare is a contemporary artist who deals with hyperrealism and strives to be technically perfect with his medium. So I had this question whether this is an appropriate description or introduction to you, and I think you've answered that. It's a tool that you use. So, but why do you feel that that much detail is important?
So this is just inner, I would say, the way you want your existence, the way you want. I mean, I don't see painting as something different from me. It is almost a part of me. It is part of me. It is coming from me. See, it's almost my existence somewhere else on the canvas, maybe. But then I also want it to be whatever I do. I mean, generally in my own practice, I like to be very neat and clean with things I do and the mannerism I try and follow, even while working. So I like that technical perfection. I mean, it has its own, you know, I mean, I could have easily photographed it, but I'm a very poor photographer. But I can, you know, capture what I really want to capture. And then painting is my prominent medium to express. So basically when I'm painting, I'm looking for a place. So, you know, you can sleep very well in your own bed. So painting is that bed for me, you know. This is my expression. This is me. But though I may be using photograph as a reference for my painting, but I only get satisfied in the painting itself. And I also see, sorry to... I also see that, you know, I paint in layers. So experience, life, situation also happens in layers. So rather what I do is I imitate the same life. I practice that visual. So photography is about click and light. But when it comes to painting, I sometimes take, I mean, the longest time I had taken for a painting is six months. So, you know, for those 6 months to have that patience, to, you know, to pursue it that passionately, that intensely, and, you know, just going with that very intense thought, going alongside and having your own, you know, mundane daily life.
You kind of live the life of that,
exactly,
that subject.
That subject, and maybe I am not trying to live that way, but at least I am trying to maximize it through my own practice. And that's how I start with drawing, and then first layer, then second layer, then almost like 15-20 layers and like hundreds of shades. And eventually that become, all those layers are painting. So what you see is not a one thing you see. I mean, definitely you see a face or a person, end result, but the whole process goes like layer by layer, layer by layer. And I like that layers. I like, I mean, we also have layers of personality. So that way, I also related with the sort of life we live.
It's all the evidence that they gather
exactly,
over time.
Exactly.
And they say art is a meditative practice. So when you do this, this is obviously you go into a certain state of mind for days and hours.
Right, right,
So
right.
have you ever felt that the painting is speaking to you?
Definitely. I mean, that's a, I mean, we I almost used to define, I mean, these days I'm in a very different state of mind, but what I used to believe in basically 15 and 16, 2015 and 16, where I was having this spiritual growth, that's what I totally believe. At that point of time, I thought, if something is teaching me, that's my painting. My love is my painting. So I used to consider my painting as a lover, or as something which is teaching me. I almost used to see it as a teacher, as a lover, as a mother, as a father, as a family person. Somewhere I can, you know, you look for a place where you can go to, a place to go to, or a comfortable situation.
Home, kind of.
Exactly. So the same feeling I had with painting, and all, like, it has taught me like a lot many things. And then definitely eventually with time you flow and you move towards different things. But you know, you cannot live a same thing twice. So it's almost like that.
But in one of your articles written about you by Riaz Como, he wrote that you're a Sisyphean artist. So as you said that you cannot live your experience again and again, but you sometimes describe your practice as Sisyphean practice. So
I totally relate to it. So how do I relate to it? So I had this thought when I was in my like almost like in that zone in 16 and 15, I almost felt like, you know, what I'm doing is I'm done with the painting after 2 months. I mean, it takes different, like for different paintings, you have different time zones. So generally I take 2 to 3 months for a painting. So, I mean, when I say that, you know, I have started with an experience and I'm done with it. So what to do now? I mean, should I paint again or should I not be painting again?
Yeah.
So for that matter, but you don't get satisfied. There's another visual which is calling. There's another zone of visuals which is keeping you pulled towards them. So for that matter, you don't get satisfied. So that's how I see myself as a Sisyphus. I mean, like, you start from the scratch and then you go up and like finish, get done with the painting, with
again.
The visual, and then starting it again with a new thing. So rather I'm doing that with the same intensity, almost like rolling stone up and then rolling it down
it's
again.
It's like living one life and starting another.
Right.
Wow.
And I like that somehow. I mean, you do get frustrated, honestly speaking, sometimes.
Yeah, do you suffer from artist block? Are you not feeling motivated enough?
Actually, you know what happens? What I think and speed of my hands are not aligned. So I can think, but generally I take a longer time to paint.
To execute.
Exactly. I mean, there have been visuals which has been with me for around 2 years or more than 2 years, and only after 2 years I could paint them. It had happened with one of the painting actually I had done. I had painted two hands. Yeah, so that painting is definitely a special painting for me.
It is amazing.
So I mean, I had captured those hands around more than 2 years ago.
Okay.
Before start painting that very visual. But then, I mean, you also digest it within you. That's what I see. I mean, I let visual get digested within me. And if it is still there, if it is still craving.
It survives.
Exactly. If it still survives, then it's my thing.
It needs to be vomited now.
Exactly.
Okay.
So that very approach I have for my own work. And it's going along for quite some time. But when it comes to artist block, yes, I do feel it. I mean, sometimes I have this fear. Oh, I just have, you know, 3 visuals, 4 visuals in my head. What happens after that?
Yeah.
But that's a good thing, no? To have that mystery, to have that, you know, uneasiness within you, that sense of fear, that keeps you going.
So you talk about fear and uncertainty, but this is an expected part of an artist's life. And I mean, when you, at whatever point you had that clarity that I want to become an artist by profession, so you must already know that this is a life of insecurity, fears, uncertainty. So how did you get that courage to still pursue this and convince your family that you have to do this?
So best thing I would say, I wasn't really aware. That's the best thing. I mean, there's this saying called ignorance is bliss, and that's true. I mean, I totally believe it. Maybe in a negative, positive, whichever way you want to take it. But if I would have known that, you have to do so much of things and so much of practice, I'd be like, oh, let's find an easy job and let's not do it. But since I wasn't really aware and was rather passionate towards it, I mean, I at that point of time, I did not really need courage. I just knew my, that very sense of intense thought that I really want to pursue, and that's it. Sometimes you have to give a shot. Sometimes you have to follow it, have to rather, just get into it and let's see if it happens or not happen. But you should be sure within you, that's the main requirement. That do you really wish to pursue it? I mean, this is your inner calling or something. So, I mean, if you would ask me that, did you always had that sort of vision, or did you know already that you would be practicing painting or something like that? Honestly speaking, I wanted to get into applied arts, which is a bit different from what I do right now, because what I had been told was you'll be earning when you do applied arts. You have a lot of scope. You'll get a job. But I couldn't get admission into applied arts. Then fortunately, so I got my admission into drawing and painting, and that's how it all started. And in my first year, I did not even know what to do with that. I was just trying to understand, absorb into it and all that. But eventually with time, I realized, oh, this is it. I mean, I'm doing this for me. I do not have to cater to anyone or to any client or something. I can do what I feel like doing. This is, I can decide. I have an authority. No one else is going to decide. So that moment, I had this thing that, oh, now I want to take it forward. But how do I take it? That took me around 10 years. Or that took me a whole long journey, that how do I do it? And still I'm in the process. I won't say that, that I definitely, I have found my way of expression, language. I'm on that path, but I'm yet to walk, for a longer period of time. I have just started. That's what I feel. And sometimes, yes, I mean, there are certain insecurities. There are certain unanswered questions within you. But it depends. If you get succumbed to them, and then that's a whole different scene. But if you still, try and move forward, move ahead, and then again try and solve, and maybe let's, some things, I mean, not everything will be answered, but that ambiguity, that sense of going, that sense of incompleteness, I mean, that's life.
Incompleteness has its own beauty. When
true.
It's complete, it's over. That's what
true,
I feel.
True.
So, about this uncertainty, and also, there is a lot of fear when you come into an artistic field. Will you earn enough? So, when did you feel that, okay, I can sustain myself to continue my practice?
Honestly speaking, I'm still not sure if I can sustain. But I have my own principle that even if I get a even if I get a single bread for a day, I'm okay with it. As far as I'm getting to eat, as far as I'm getting to survive. So my trick is to minimize my expenses. My trick is to minimize my lifestyle so I can still follow my practice. I do not want any compromise when it comes to my practice. And things will follow, definitely. I'm not that much of scared of, should I be concerned about selling my works and all that? That will happen with the time. And I do not know from where I get that confidence. That will happen. People would like it. They may not like it. That's okay. But I'll survive. That's for sure. So, but when I'm surviving, I just do not want to do some mediocre stuff. I mean, I hate mediocrity when it comes to at least work. When it comes to your soul feeding. So, I mean, that way I do not really see that adjustment into my work. And I want it to be pure piece of whatever I do, expression, art, or yeah, like that.
Then how was your experience at Switzerland Art Residency? Do you feel a difference after coming back, and how's the scene there?
Definitely, it was like for the second time when I was going out of the country, and it was a for a good period of time what I was going to spend there. So definitely a different mannerism, different visuals, different zone of art. people, their own, the whole visual experience, the whole visual, mental, physical experience of being there has definitely contributed. Yet I could also see like India from a different perspective, which was necessary. And there has been positive, negative, like lot many sort of experiences. When you come back again, look back into time, or when you are already there, then you like look into your own city, life, country from that point of time. So that really generates lot many experiences. And I think I would say on each moment I was trying to learn, I was trying to see, and that's how it has a lot of contribution. I would say I got exposed to like many masters from that trip, and I could see them in person, which was quite having goosebumps and having that, you know, that that it's
surreal.
Yeah, it's almost it feels real, surreal, like everything at the same time, and you really get it is exciting. But then also you have to, you know, digest it. So you're not shaking within like your beliefs of art or anything. At the end, you have a control of your art. You have control. That doesn't mean that, you know, I control everything of my practice or something. But you're going to be producer of what you do. So in that context, you have to be stable. You have to be also going through all the experiences, yet you have to balance yourself in order to not getting influenced totally by the, you have to, so my thing is, rather my practice goes like, I take photograph as a reference. It's almost like imitation, almost like reliving the whole thing. But I am not much interested in imitating things. My thing is to digest it first and then see if it is happening. So after learning, you have to unlearn it, unlearn it, and then you have to see if it is coming. If it is coming, then it's yours.
Do you think that the audience, did you expect something different from your audience, or are you unhappy with something in the industry?
See, it depends. I mean, definitely everyone is unhappy with the kind of work they do, whatever sort of, with so much of heart people are doing their work. But definitely not everything goes according to your own thing. Market is not going to follow your way of, you have to somehow get adjacent to it. But that doesn't mean you have to make compromises. You have to follow your own thing, market or whatever profession or whatever the industry, wherever it is going, they'll follow their own mannerisms. So I do not know, I do not necessarily follow what is happening in the market. Rather, I really need to concentrate on what I do. If market has to follow, it'll follow. If it doesn't follow, that's my destiny or whatsoever. I'm quite open to that.
But they say to understand art, one also has to be educated. So do you feel dissatisfied sometimes that what you're trying to express doesn't reach enough people as much as you want?
See, I mean, definitely it's a good question, but I cannot take every responsibility of, you know, making people understand my art and everything. People will also have to come and make their own efforts to understand. They are understanding art for their own sake. I am doing art for my own sake first. So definitely you also have to learn how to look at art. You also have to see if you can understand it, if you can ask them. You just cannot, you know, come and say, I don't understand it. Sometimes I do not understand some part of expression, some part of art, or some part of literature. But you have to know more about it. Why it is like that? What is the perspective? What is the take? So you also have to get into the background. Not that everything will be spoon-feeded or come to you directly and easily on, like in a plate. So you also have to make efforts.
Equal efforts.
Yep.
Coming from both sides and meet at
true,
one end.
True, true, yeah.
So when you talk about education, information, knowledge comes from a lot of sources. So do you also have other interests and other interests in art history, cultures? Does it all help, and how important is it?
So, if I talk about my inspiration or what I look up to, or,
yes,
you know, I look up to everything. I mean, I am not a regular reader, but I like knowing things. I like knowing characters. I like seeing movies. And I like knowing about cinema. Though I do not have much of insight into cinema, but I like about, you know, how do you make it? What is direction? And, you know, how, which director is working in which way, how do they handle, because cinema is a very large canvas. So you have to have that organizational skill where you encompass everything and you have to be a leader. But when it comes to painting or poetry, you have a certain zone where you can play, and that is in your hand. I'm not saying that is easy, but that is in your, you know, reach. So about films, about poetry, I like poetry. And then I visit places. I like cities. City has their own texture, people, culture, food. Everything talks about, you know, city, mannerism, people, community. So everything has their own way of being, seeing, having those architectural existence, places, people. So, I mean, these are inspiring as well. But I also see that, you know, this should not be coming directly to my work. I mean, why directly? It may be an irrational part that I do not want it to be direct. I cannot really have answer for it, but that's how I really don't want it. I mean, I do not want it to be directly coming into my work and let's paint Nagpur, let's paint Bangalore, let's paint Baroda. It has to inspire you in some or the other ways. I like visiting older markets. Those, it's almost like visiting back into time. It's almost like visiting or talking to that time zone. So when you go to Banaras, it's a whole different feel. It's a whole, you go like around, let's say, 300-400s behind than what are that kind of time you are seeing. So that structure, those smells, and small lanes, you know, everything has their own way of speaking. And I do get inspired from that as well, like tree, nature, sea, mountains, everything. I mean, I'm yet to explore much of it, but yes, I'm hopeful about it.
Yeah, we are made of our experiences, and it doesn't have to directly reflect. But your work in Varanasi was also very, very amazing. The one you did for Asian Paints Initiative, it was absolutely stunning. Okay, so see, there are a lot of us who are hesitant to get out of these the secured life or the conventional way of life, safe life, where life with no risks, right? So you are certainly living an uncertain life. What would you, what word of advice or what would you say to somebody who is afraid to live the life they dream?
See, you have to get out firstly. I mean, I do not know if I can suggest, rather I'm living what I feel like doing. So you have to go out and do things. There's no other alternative. You cannot just be safe and do, when you're in a safe zone, you do not have much exciting things to do. You're already secured, you're already, you know, in that comfortable space. So, but when uncertainty comes with a lot of thrill, uncertainty comes with a lot of insecurity, uncertainty comes with a lot of fear. But it also depends like how you really want to, you know, go about it. If you can, you know, just digest it within you and make your space on top of it or make a facade over it, you can very well survive and things will definitely follow. It's just that, you know, you also have to be aware that you have to leave some mundane things. Like there are certain things which I don't do or which are not part of my usual daily life. Sometimes I go to malls and like big places and I feel like, oh, this part of life also exists. And this is not part of my life.
Regular.
It is not that I cannot live that life, but my zone is very different. I have to be there. So when I be there, I cannot be here. So you have to choose. And that's very important what you choose.
So you also have moments of frustration when
True. I mean,
you go on.
Giving up, I won't say giving up, but frustrated sometimes that, you know, things are not moving. That happens. That happens to everyone. And that is quite normal. But that keeps you going as well, because if the whole day would be stagnant, happy, you know, or let's say whole day would be very painful and sorrow and, you know, all those gloomy feelings,
just
and
one
all that
tone.
It's, yeah, so no one tone will make you survive. It's like vibration. What is going up will also come down, and you know that the whole thing,
that's how it moves forward.
Exactly. So that way is I see it.
That is absolutely amazing, and we are even more inspired by you right now after knowing so many things. And I know there are endless other things to unfold, and I'm sure we'll have more opportunities to talk to you as we go along. I thank you for your time, and thank you so much for coming here.
Thank you very much for inviting me, and this has been a wonderful conversation for quite some time. So I enjoyed it. Thank you.
Bye-bye.